Conway Hall, London, where ethics matter.
delighted to be able to offer you now the world premiere of a new piano trio by Robert Saxton, who I'm very pleased to say is here with us tonight. And rather than me waffle on about it, I think it'd be good if Robert, if he would like to, would come up on stage and say a few words about his piece. Robert, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. I'll stay down here.
You're going to stay down there. Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
I was going to hijack you, Robert, with some questions, but I'll do it from here to you, if that's what I'll
yes,
say.
Yes, absolutely.
As Tim says, you know, I don't think we have Haydn in the room, or Schubert, but it is wonderful for us as performers always to work with living composers. Because for me, it's a kind of a door back into this creativity of, you know, how does these amazing pieces come into fruition? Because it's the same process as, I suppose, a play. And this is a set of fantasy pieces. I should just say, first of all, that even though it's a premiere tonight, and it's always, you know, the pressure of the premiere is always there, but we have actually, fortunately, due to the pandemic, been living with this piece for over a year. So it's a really special to actually be able to share it publicly with you. But Robert, I wouldn't mind if you could just share a little bit of thoughts about it's six interlocked movements. It's called Fantasy Pieces. Maybe tell us a little bit of why it's called Fantasy Pieces, or where that idea of fantasy comes from, or how it relates to music. And also, another pertinent question, did you write the six movements in the order we hear them?
Right, thanks, Darren. Well, I was going to say after the Haydn, follow that. I'm not sure I can, but one of the reasons that these pieces are called, or this piece is called Fantasy Pieces, is Schumann, Robert Schumann, that is, well, to be careful these days, not Clara in this case. Robert Schumann wrote an Opus 88 set of Fantasy Pieces for piano trio, and I wasn't in any way trying to imitate Schumann, or indeed there's no quotations of his music in my piece or anything, but I was interested in the way Schumann, in his other works that are short pieces that make a bigger piece, like Carnival or Papillon, that many of you may know for solo piano, writes character pieces which are interrelated in certain ways, but also have very distinct personalities, like almost like postcards. So that was one thing. The other thing was the personalities of the trio, who very kindly agreed to give the premiere of this piece, and you've just heard them playing wonderfully in that Haydn, and it's a great treat for a composer to work with living players, like a playwright working with a chamber theatre with just two or three actors, and that's a great privilege. As for writing in order, this is a very interesting question, because I always start thinking I'm going to write in order, and then of course it all goes wrong. Sketch pages appear which weren't meant to be sketches, and more sketches. And eventually I wrote the pieces almost in the order you hear them, because the plan was a very simple one, and I'll just outline it. By the way, the whole piece lasts about 16 minutes, so you'll know what you're in for, okay? It begins with an active, I would say, rather than a fast movement, where the piano is playing fast semi-quaver figurations, and the strings end up playing that music, and they sort of reverse roles, really, like that. That goes straight, there are no breaks between the pieces, rather than movements. The second movement is a slow movement, which is just one line that goes from the violin right down to the bottom of the cello, and the piano's role, each of these pieces, by the way, has particular technical and musical combined premise. So the second one is this line, and the piano echoes around the line. So there's no harmony in a traditional sense. It's monodic or monophonic. That leads straight into what in a classical piece would have been a scherzo. It's a dance, a very difficult one, which they play brilliantly. And that goes into a movement where you will hear them all playing the same type of music. It's as if the whole ensemble has become one instrument. And eventually that explodes into a second slow movement, which is the fifth of the six pieces, which is like a chorale or a hymn. The cello and violin are in unison virtually the whole time, and the piano, as it rotates very slowly around this long melodic line, the piano plays chords which are initially very sustained and then become more and more bell-like. I won't say any more about it because we'll be here all night. And then that eventually goes into the final and longest movement, which in a way takes up unfinished business from the first movement. And you'll hear how it ends. I won't say more about that, except I would like just to say one thing more, apart from thank you, the trio. You have in your program notes that Haydn wrote in 1795, his piano trio went on his second London visit. And it is interesting just to us to think, having heard that magnificent piece just now, that it was written about 2 miles from here in a house just off Piccadilly. Those things, I think, make not only us feel part of something much larger, but also it seems to me that when you're a composer writing for a standard combination like the piano trio or the string quartet, which both were invented or developed during the great classic period of classical music in the Austro-German repertoire, Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven, Schubert, as you will hear in the second half, one has to rethink how to write for the medium. In the Haydn, for example, the cello is often, a lot of the time, doubling the left hand of the piano. You will hear in the Schubert, it becomes more free. And so for a composer working in what is a standard medium or an historic and great medium, you have to rethink it from the ground up nowadays. And that was a tremendous challenge. And thank you for facing it.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.